Hi, everyone. We're going to give it just a minute or so for everyone to kind of populate the room. But thanks for joining us on a Monday. Everyone should have the ability to access the chat, so you are more than welcome to say hello in there at any point. And I will go into some more of the technical aspects in just a few minutes. But everyone is being prompt as usual, which is always highly appreciated. So let me start by sharing my screen. Okay. Well, welcome everyone to today's C2C Care webinar program. My name is Robin Bauer-Kilgo, and I'm coming in from you just outside of Washington, D.C. in Silver Spring, Maryland. I'm just going to run through a couple of quick slides, and then we're going to go ahead and start today's program. Again, my name is Robin Bauer-Kilgo. I am the C2C Care Coordinator, and you can reach me at c2cc@culturalheritage.org with any questions you might have. This is our home on the web, connectingtocollections.org. On that website, you will find our entire archive of online programming, which is quite impressive. If you actually dig around in it, we've been doing this program for over 10 years. So I encourage you to go take a look at it. Webinars, courses, curated resources are on there, and a link to our moderated community. So if you're new to our program, I encourage you to go and click around and see some of our past programming that we have. We also have two homes online for updates for social media. We have our Facebook community and our Twitter profile. So if you're interested in announcements or anything else related to the program itself, I encourage you to go follow those if you're on either one of those outlets. We are using Zoom webinar today, so a couple of quick technical notes on that. As a participant, you have access to a chat box, which is an excellent place to say hello, maybe comment on the weather. We had some wild weather here outside of Washington, D.C. over the weekend, but now it's turning lovely and everything's blooming. So I encourage you to talk about that or maybe say where you're from. You also have access to a Q&A box. In the Q&A box, you can actually ask questions of our presenter today. I encourage you to use that Q&A box for questions. If you put them in the chat, we can kind of lose them sometimes due to the stream of consciousness and the way the chat runs. So again, use that Q&A box for any kind of questions you might have at any point during the program. I also wanted to let everyone know that we are recording today's webinar. So once it's done, we will be posting it on both our website and the FAIC YouTube channel. We've also enabled closed captioning. So if you hit the CC button at the bottom of the screen, you will be able to see closed captioning while we go through the program. A quick upcoming programming note: on May 2nd, 2023 at 2 o'clock Eastern. So we're doing it a little later than our usual 1 o'clock time. We're gonna be doing some joint May Day programming with the emergency programs run by FAIC. May Day is an excellent yearly program where we basically ask for everyone to just do one small thing to look at their emergency plans and get prepared to deal with emergencies throughout the year. The webinar for that day is going to be Where to Find Aid and How to Get Training for Disasters. We've partnered with a bunch of great organizations, including the folks from FEMA, Smithsonian, and architectural groups. Also, to talk a little bit about just where to find aid, how to get some training if you are interested in pursuing that kind of idea for your institution, a lot of other fun emergency stuff. So, and also we're going to be featuring FAIC's program. So if you are interested in emergency planning, which is also one of my areas I'm interested in, I encourage you to join us for that joint program. So I'm going to go ahead and stop sharing my screen, and I'm going to introduce our presenter today. Their name is Marguerite Schlinder. They're the principal conservator at Pearl Preservation LLC, a preventative conservation consultation and services firm. This lecture on caring for Judaica and museum collections will provide cultural background and practical advice for collections care professionals. And we encourage everyone to just be mindful of the chat, be aware that, you know, this we can be talking about some sensitive information here and some cultural sensitivity, but we know everyone in our audience is fabulous and we'll be polite and keep everything in a nice tone. So without further ado, I'm gonna go ahead and hand this over to Marguerite. Marguerite, feel free to take over whenever you're ready.
Thank you, Robin. And thank you, Connecting to Collections Care, for having me, for having these webinars that live on in the internet in perpetuity and are a great resource for those with questions. And I'm here to answer some questions for those caring for Judaica in many different ways. Can everyone see the PowerPoint? Can I get a thumbs up? Yes. Okay, great.
Yeah, it looks perfect. Thanks. Feel free.
Excellent. Excellent. So as Robin said, my name is Marguerite Schindler. I use they, them pronouns. I'm a graduate from the Winterthur University of Delaware program in art conservation with a specialty in preventive conservation and a focus in working with Judaica. And so I'm here today to kind of synthesize all of that into one webinar of 45 minutes. And so here is my email, pearlpreservation22@gmail.com. And I encourage you to reach out with any additional questions or clarifications that might come up during today's talk. So first, let's do a quick little check-in. I was introduced to this visual recently during a trauma-informed training for art educators, and I just love it and want to share it with as many people as possible. So just take a minute to look at the graphic and see how maybe you're feeling today. And if you feel comfortable, you can share your number in the chat. And you know, maybe if someone's feeling a 7, there's a 6 out there to give them some support today. So I just offer this as a time for reflection now, but also a great graphic that I hope you, you know, use going forward. So I'd like to start by acknowledging the land that I have the privilege to live and work on. I believe that a land acknowledgement is about understanding our personal relationship with the land that we're on and how we got here. For me, both sides of my family originate in Eastern Europe and came to this land as Holocaust survivors and refugees, and they were given sanctuary from violent persecution and complete displacement. On both sides, I'm the second generation to be born on this territory, which itself came from the violent persecution and displacement of Indigenous people. By acknowledging the Lenni Lenape and Wenake Hokan communities, I can begin to embody the Jewish value of tikkun olam, healing the world through reparative social justice. So with that, I acknowledge that I currently reside on the unceded ancestral Indigenous territory of the Lenni Lenape and Wenake Hokan people of the Delaware watershed, who stewarded these lands for centuries and continue to do so. There we go. So I know that people from all different backgrounds are joining from this webinar. I'm really grateful to have been asked by this group because I know that the audience is mostly collections care folks at small and medium sized institutions who may or may not have a conservator on staff or have access to conservation information and may have little or no previous knowledge of Judaism or Judaica. So there's kind of a wide breadth of folks coming in with different amounts of knowledge and experience. And so while the primary audience are those kind of collection care professionals, for those of you who are watching this, looking to take care of your collections and heirlooms at home, or for those who are at Jewish institution and already have a solid grasp on the Jewish content and are looking for more collections care advice, I hope you also learn here. And I encourage you to reach out if you have any additional questions. Jewish people and material culture. People of the book, we love our stuff. Jewish people have been thinking about ritual objects and holiness from biblical times to the present. The Torah itself, the Jewish Bible, has many descriptions of objects and rituals that utilize them. After the destruction of the Second Temple in 70 CE, prayer-based Jewish worship emerged and evolved simultaneously with the advent of rabbis. These learned scholars read and reviewed the Torah and debated their lessons down to the specifics. These debates are captured in the Talmud and Gemara, which are records of these historic rabbinic opinions and debates. And this tradition continues to this day as scholars continue to think, discuss, and write about their understanding of Jewish material culture based on a mixture of halakha, which is Jewish rabbinic law, and their lived experience. And I have an annotated bibliography with lots of recommended reading. And I'll point you in that direction towards the end of the talk. So wrestling with text and tradition and interacting with Judaism by questioning and by re-examining our Jewish values. And this type of engagement can be seen as religious practice. Per a recent study by the Pew Research Center, Jewish Americans in 2020, which I guess it's not so new anymore, their numbers, it was a very interesting study. I recommend that you read it if you're interested in this topic. And more Jewish Americans these days experience their Judaism in two increasingly divergent ways. One focused on kind of traditional religious practice, and the other focused on non-traditional explorations of Jewish life and ritual. One thing that connects these two ways of thinking is Jewish material culture, Judaica, ritual objects, art, and historic artifacts. 80% of Jews in the US say they own a menorah, 56 a Seder plate, more than half. And so really there's a lot of stuff in the Jewish culture and many, many people appreciate it. So what is Judaica? What are we actually talking about? What does that word mean? It can mean a lot of things. Judaica can include all the objects of Jewish religious observance, religious, ceremonial, and life cycle objects. I think that Jewish art can also include secular fine arts and crafts made by Jewish people that may contain Jewish themes or narratives, or maybe connect to a significant Jewish historical event or place. Often anything with Hebrew letters or writing is considered connected to Judaism. So too are objects connected to Israel or Israeli makers. This, however, is extremely nuanced and carries with it political tensions. When considering the Jewish people, it is important not to conflate the three separate but interrelated Israels. Am Yisrael, the people of Israel, that is all Jews everywhere. Eretz Yisrael, the land of Israel, and Medinat Yisrael, the state of Israel, as represented by its government. They are all separate, and every Jewish person has their own unique connections, feelings, and engagement with each Israel. These examples of subtlety, intricacy, and complexity are an argument for community members to be part of heritage care. Without their input and guidance, perhaps our current conservation or collection care practices that treat cultural objects simply as material objects and not full, layered, complicated objects that they truly are, is doing a disservice to both the objects and their communities. So you can see that Judaica can be defined in many different ways. My working definition that I hope we can take forward into this talk is all objects that catalyze Jewish ways of being. But I'm sure that when you signed up for this talk, you were not thinking about all objects that catalyze Jewish ways of being. I'm sure you were thinking about these objects where there's no mistaking that they are used in traditional Jewish rituals and Jewish homes. These types of objects have a long history of use and therefore a long history of understanding. These are objects that may have additional sacred considerations that you should be aware of or at least know who to ask. So according to the traditional classifications of sacred Jewish objects, there are these four categories. Some categories have more strict rules, others are more relaxed. These traditional classifications only consider traditional ritual objects and are based on Jewish rabbinic law. So those highlighted green ritual and sacred objects we saw from the slide before. In this system, there is a hierarchy, as you see here, and rules that dictate how they are to be made, handled, repaired, and disposed of through burial based on how they're classified. So really, in this spectrum of classifications, clay kodesh are the ones that are most complicated. They're the holiest objects, literally translates to vessels of holiness. And they're the most sacred because they have the name of God written on them one or more times. They are considered sacred whether or not they are in use. Examples of these clay kodesh, objects that contain the written name of God, are the Sefer Torah, the Torah scroll, tefillin, and mezuzah. The parchments inside all of which are carefully crafted by a sofer or a scribe who must handwrite each letter flawlessly. Other objects fall into one of these three additional categories, each different in particular ways. For the sake of collection care practices, they can all be considered not sacred and don't have the same sort of considerations that clay kodesh might. And I'll take a moment here to pause and point out the Tashmishe Kedusha line, where you can see an image of a mezuzah. So there's a small scroll of parchment with a handwritten prayer and text inside. And that parchment is clay kodesh, and it is housed inside this little box that is Tashmishe Kedusha, because it is in direct contact with that holy object. And so that's an example of kind of the intricacies where understanding how pieces of objects and how they're used relate to one another can inform how to care for them in your collections. So the clay kodesh life cycle, this is the one that's the most complicated. The very creation of these clay kodesh items involves spiritual kavanah, which is intention, to infuse them with kedusha, holiness. Objects that are traditionally more holy have special handling guidelines aimed at preserving the structural integrity of the ink on the parchment and the legibility of the text, which, if damaged, deems the object no longer kosher or fit for ritual use. Likewise, religious manuscripts that time or human error has rendered unfit cannot be thrown out, but rather require geniza, which is removal. The concept is that these works, like people, different than people, but like people, are living things and possess an element of sacredness. So when they die or become worn out, they must be honored and protected from profanation or misuse. In some communities, texts stored in a geniza would eventually be buried alongside a righteous individual in a Jewish cemetery. More frequently, scrolls and scraps were ritually consigned to their own burial plot. And in other cases, some communities appear to have used this removal to this nook or box of a geniza as the terminal state of the process. And they kind of stayed there without going into the ground, but were still removed in a careful and intentional way. And I hope this slide, for the conservators or for those considering treatment, I hope this slide helps you understand when to ask for help, because there is some damage that is okay to be fixed by a conservator and some damage that is not. If it has to be made kosher again, that is a job for a sofer or soferet, not for a conservator. So we've talked about these traditional classifications, but I'm also really interested in what Rabbi Vanessa Oakes proposes in one of my favorite books, Inventing Jewish Ritual. She proposes this non-hierarchical system with two categories, explicitly Jewish objects and implicitly Jewish objects. And this system considers but does not privilege rabbinic interpretation of Jewish law. And it aims to be more people-oriented by making space for more Jewish tradition. Explicitly Jewish objects signify that Jewish life is being intentionally constructed. They are articulate, revelatory, self-evident, and unambiguous, which I think is the key word there. They can establish Jewish identities and serve as reminders that they exist in a setting that is Jewish, and they create an occupied Jewish space. A Torah scroll, a mezuzah, a Seder plate are examples of explicitly Jewish objects. There's no mistaking their meaning. Implicitly Jewish objects may not readily reveal the Jewish work they do. They're not overt signs or props, but they can still participate in the fulfillment of commandments or embody Jewish values and concepts. An example of this is books in a Jewish household. Some might be explicitly Jewish, a siddur, a prayer book, a book in Hebrew, a Passover cookbook. All of those signify that it is a Jewish space. However, the Jewish values of curiosity, learning, and asking questions are embodied in all the books, making the whole library implicitly Jewish. This wider definition requires people to be involved with the object and may in some ways confuse you if you're thinking, is what I'm looking at Judaica? Is it, the question really is it traditional Judaica that is unambiguous and explicitly Jewish? Or is it in some way connected to the Jewish people implicitly in a way where connecting with communities and asking questions is the way to be best in service of the objects and by extension, the communities? So I'm going to spend the next few slides talking about the Torah scroll itself. It has the most extreme creation and care needs and exemplifies kind of one extreme end of the Judaica care spectrum. Here you can see an image of several Sefrei Torah with various dressings and accoutrements, which is where a lot of regional and cultural variants will come in artistic styles and how the aesthetics and what materials are used. But you'll notice that they're stored in an alcove with one or more curtains or screens that can open and close. This is called an Aron Kodesh, a holy ark. The Aron is reminiscent of the biblical tabernacle and is said to contain the spirit of God and of Torah. It is considered special, sacred, and safe. So not only does it have a sacred presence and its own associated rituals, but it also serves as collection storage that buffers from large swings in relative humidity, protects from light, pests, and dusts. So here is a diagram of the Torah scroll and some of its accoutrements. So my goal in including this is to give you a reference point so that you have some terminology to pull from when going through your collections in understanding what it is that you actually have and how you should be referring to them. Additionally, you can see here that the Sefer Torah, the parchment itself, is the clay kodesh, the highest tier of holy status. And all of these accoutrements, these adornments, are that second tier, that tashmishe mitzvah or tashmishe kedusha, which do not have the same care or creation requirements. And so I hope that this diagram can help you identify and work with the objects that you have in your collection. These images show a sofer, a scribe, in various steps of creating the Torah scroll. The sofer handwrites each letter absolutely flawlessly. If there's any error, they would use a very fine scalpel, like you see in the bottom left corner, to scratch off the ink in the first layer of parchment so that the letter can be rewritten rather than having to replace the entire panel of parchment. This work should only be done by a trained sofer or soferet. And you can also see here the sofer sewing together panels of parchment with text on them. And that is another way to manage a repair. If a panel is damaged and is no longer kosher, one option is to remove that panel by unsewing it and replacing it with a kosher one. I learned today, because I was researching for this talk, that a Torah, depending on the size of the animals used for the parchment, can contain between 60 and 80 panels of parchment. And I think that's pretty significant because you really get one good piece of parchment like this, large enough to use for a panel, one per animal. So that's, you know, 60 to 80 lives that literally go into making this. And that too, I think, really adds to the sacred element and the respect and reverence that we should have in taking care of it and respect the lives that gave to it. This image shows a Torah scroll in use for the ritual chanting service that happens several times a week. You can see here that the text is very specific. This font with the little crowns is particular to the Torah scroll. You don't really see it anywhere else. It's a very particular font. And the way the text is written in columns is standardized. And so these handwritten columns and letters and panels are exactly the same in every single handwritten scroll. There's just so much tradition and passing on how these things are done that standardized manufacture by hand, I think is pretty incredible. But I will say not everything is standardized. As you can see, here are some dark patches, and that is likely pigmentation from the animal that gave us this parchment panel. And so there's still definitely ways to connect back to the life, to the nature, and to the, you know, not everything is governable. You can write in perfect columns and you'll still have spots, and that's okay. Additionally, I'd like to point out this tool, which is called a yad. It means hand. And it was developed as a way to preserve the Torah scroll because the text is the most important. And if a reader was using their finger to keep track of their place, they may introduce oils into the scroll and cause damage. And so this piece of Judaica, the yad, was developed to mitigate that and has become its own form of Judaica and has expanded from there. But interesting that it kind of started as a preservation tool. So we've talked about the Torah, which is parchment and ink and sinew, which sews it together, and those wooden rollers, those etz chaim. But when we're talking about Judaica at large, or Judaic collections or institutions, what types of materials are represented? How should you be thinking about these objects from a material standpoint? And the answer is complicated because it's all objects, all materials. And so it's important to use existing collection care resources for care or handling of these various materials. Ceramic is ceramic, glass is glass. And so, reaching out to experts and conservators who specialize in those, or connecting to the myriad of resources that exist online by material, is a great place to get started. When we're talking about the clay kodesh objects, our Torah, tefillin, and mezuzah, these holy handwritten texts on parchment are both the most holy and have those additional considerations, and also the most sensitive to deterioration. Parchment is very sensitive to changes in relative humidity and is also pretty delicious for any pests who might come along. So while I can't give advice for every single material you may encounter in this collection, I thought I would share this query that I received from a paper conservator. They reached out to me from a paper lab working on a ketubah, which is a marriage contract, also handwritten on parchment, but does not usually contain the name of God and is therefore not clay kodesh, not top tier holy, is just parchment with text. However, the conservator was looking to consolidate flaking media on the parchment and was looking for a sympathetic adhesive. Using gelatin from pigs or horses would not have been appropriate, as they're not kosher animals. It would have been disrespectful to introduce those materials to a Jewish object. And so together we found an alternative. We found a food grade fish-based gelatin. I shared with her a handout on kosher certification symbols and what to look out for and what they mean. And because it is food grade, it needs to be certified kosher if that is its intended use. And so because we have that certification, it is guaranteed that the animal and the processing are kosher. And in addition, because it's protein-based, it's also sympathetic to the work on parchment, which is also proteinaceous. So we found a protein-based adhesive that met both the cultural needs of respecting kashrut and the material needs of being sympathetic to this work on parchment. So how do you know if an object has additional requirements? If you're going through your storage, how would you know? this flowchart is a quick place to start. First, figure out what sort of object it is and if it contains the name of God. Consider reaching out to me. I'm always happy to answer questions and look at the, you know, blurry pictures of things you send me. It's always fun and interesting, and I love supporting y'all, so please do reach out. And then examine the letters, I think, is the biggest condition issue to be concerned about, because the legibility and perfection of the written letters are what deems it kosher or not. So examining the condition of the letters and their adhesion to the surface, I think, is the first thing that you should be looking at. And after that, talk to a sofer or talk to me and I'll connect you to one. So a little bit of a pivot, a little bit thinking less literally, more creatively, more metaphorically. But I will share this project that I worked on in connection with the Jewish Museum of Maryland. Ariel Tonkin was an artist who contributed several pieces to this exhibit called A Fence Around the Torah, including this hybrid ritual object. Ariel wove the piece using recycled and hand-dyed threads to create this like very exaggerated, super long tallit prayer shawl-like object. After the exhibition, the object had to travel back across the country and needed a transport container to protect it from wrinkling and additional support during transit. So I built this custom archival box that could serve as a storage and a transport container, and drove down to meet for de-installation, and we rolled it up and tucked it away. And so this box itself is really nothing too special. It's a pretty standard custom housing using archival quality materials. Pretty standard. But the coolest part for me is when Ariel sent a thank you note and called the storage box an Our Own Kodesh. Now, if you remember, we talked about that a few slides back. The Our Own Kodesh is the special box or nook where communities store their Torah scrolls, their sacred objects. So Ariel's connection really warmed my heart because it kind of took something pretty mundane, secular, and elevated it to make it feel holy and special. And I really hope to continue to bring this kind of cross-thinking and a value-based approach to my ongoing work. We talked a little bit about intention. Kavanah is a mindfulness practice. It exists in a lot of different ways in Judaism. But like I said before, it is practiced by scribes when making and preparing holy texts. They get themselves into a state of mind of complete focus and respect. Kavanah requires both freedom from extraneous thoughts and distractions and the cognizance that a person is standing before a divine presence. And I thought that was pretty cool. I think intention is great in a lot of ways in many different areas of life. So I did a little bit more research and I learned that this actually comes from Maimonides, who is a famous medieval scholar and commentator. And he states that there are five elements to proper prayer. The first of which is kavanah, this intention and mindfulness. Then clean hands, a covered body, a clean space, and removal of distractions. I don't know about you, but those all sound like really good habits to pick up anyway in collections care spaces, regardless of if you're working with Judaica or not. Clean spaces, closed-toed shoes in the lab, clean hands, removal of distractions, all of those are good practice to be doing regardless of the type of object or collection. So some practical steps. Determine the type of object. If you don't know, ask. I'm always available, your local community. is available. Many universities have Hillel or Chabad House on campus. They're always very kind. In fact, the images you see here of me teaching a class about the Torah scroll at the University of Delaware, we borrowed a Torah scroll from the Hillel and had to trek it across campus. And we had a couple of options. We could have put it on a cart. I was really nervous about how shaky that was going to be. So our solution was to use a blanket that we had because it was a little bit drizzly. So we covered the object and I carried it, you know, in the proper Torah carrying position that has it secured from the bottom and safely resting against your body. I felt very in control of the object. It wasn't going anywhere. It was not too heavy. And so even just wrapping the object and carrying it by hand are thoughtful practices that you can take as one example and apply to your situation, however it makes sense. Basic storage is okay. It doesn't have to be fancy. If it buffers against those agents of deterioration, it's doing a great job. I will say though that consider where you store the objects. That can be a sign of respect or not. Objects on the ground is not a great idea for water and pests, but also is not, you know, the most respectful place for objects of status. So consider where in your storage space they live. And again, if you have any questions, please reach out. Additionally, I presented this poster at AIC last year that details additional practical steps regarding storage and handling. This exists online. It will be shared in the annotated bibliography that FAIC is sharing out today, but covers things like storage, handling, emergency preparedness, behavior and conduct around objects, fixing problems, when you should and when you should ask for help, and embracing end of life for some objects and what that can and should look like in institutions. And if you found this interesting, I wrote a whole bunch about it. And I'm really excited to share that it is all synthesized in a chapter in the upcoming publication, Prioritizing People in Ethical Decision-Making and Caring for Cultural Heritage Collections, Religious Values as Conservation Practice. And I talk about a lot of the topics that we discussed in this lecture. And I additionally discussed the paradox of the Holocaust Torah, which, you know, little teaser is that if the Torah is supposed to be buried, if it's no longer fit for ritual use, and we have Torahs that survived the Holocaust and have this like really powerful historic and memorial value, does that memorial and educational value supersede its need for burial requirements? And so I won't answer that here, and I'll have you read the chapter to find out the answer. And so with that, here are some favorite resources. Additionally, I've been putting together on my Instagram this Judaica 101 series, I guess you can call it. So if you follow at Pearl Preservation on Instagram, you'll be up to date with these kind of deeper dives into the specifics of particular pieces of Judaica and their materials. And it's also being done in partnership with culture.org, which launches today, which is a hub of Jewish art, both contemporary and older. And I'm grateful to be partnering with them on this Judaica 101 series. And so with that, thank you for having me. Chag Sameach to those who are celebrating Passover this week. And I suppose I can stop sharing and open the floor for questions.
That was great. Thank you. It's fascinating to me about how you were talking about how that idea of intention, like that really hit a chord with me today, because as I've told Marguerite and some of my other friends, like we're doing a room swap in my house, and my poor kids, every time you move something, I'm like, intentional thought on where this thing is going, like before we start shifting it around the house, which is a huge tenet of just museum moving, right? Mm-hmm. You don't start moving objects around until you really sit there and you think, okay, where are the issues that we're going to hit? You know what I mean? As we move things around and just all these kind of this bubble of stuff surrounding dealing with objects and stuff. It's fascinating that that's like held within text, you know what I mean? From years ago. So thank you for saying that. I found that fascinating.
Thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that example. Rule is you don't pick up an object unless you have a place you're going to put it down. And so you got to have step two before you take step one. And that takes intention for sure.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. It's been the mantra around the house. And I'm sure everyone in my family is very sick of me saying it, but that is literally what we were doing this weekend. Okay. So we already have some questions coming in. So let's go ahead and start hitting them just so we can start going through. And I'm going to encourage our audience to please feel free to put those questions in the Q&A box. Again, it just helps us track them a little bit more than in the chat box. You can access the Q&A box. If you look down at your Zoom toolbar, there should be a little box along there that just says Q&A. Just click on that. And you can pop a question in there. Okay. It operates just like the chat box. So the first one we have is, in what category of treatment do the crowns on the top of the Torah fall in? Since they are silver, they can tarnish. Is it a common practice to clean the tarnish off? So what do you think about that one?
Good question. We can even go back to the slide that talks about that. Let me double check myself before I say that. Can I share screen again?
Yeah, go for it.
So here we are. The crown up here, the finials, the breastplates are also often silver. And so they are not the top tier. They themselves do not necessarily have the name of God written on them the way that the parchment does. They're second tier. They're objects that come in contact with that holy object. So yes, cleaning is allowed, you know, from a, you know, rabbinic law perspective. But like all cleaning of silver, there are many factors. Is it solid? Is it plated? Is there value in the tarnish? Are you looking for it to be brand new? If you polish it, how quickly will it tarnish again? And what are you doing to prevent and mitigate that? So all of those questions still apply.
Yeah, there's some definite rules too. And when it comes to cleaning silver, and I'm not a conservator, I am a trained registrar, that whenever I would actually think about cleaning things, I would reach out to my friends who work with metals a lot and really get the proper solvents and all that kind of stuff. Cause they're the folks who are really going to know like what's good to use, what's not good to use, how to store it. Then, you know what I mean? Like it's, again, it's kind of like what you refer to, that it's always good to have these people to reach out to and reference to when it comes to storing these types of things for sure.
Totally. I'll also throw out that, you mentioned solvents and like cleaning materials, that sort of stuff. There's like health hazards and considerations. So PPE and knowing those and being in a space that has good ventilation and all of that stuff is important.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, we're getting into the bailiwick of regular museum or, you know, museum stuff that's all drilled into our heads as we go through our training programs. Generally speaking, what temperature and humidity are recommended for Kaleo Kadosh objects to be stored in?
Oh, wow.
Is that a big question?
Oh my God, I have so many feelings.
This temperature and humidity thing has been really like burying its head in a lot of our programming lately. It is fascinating just talking about sustainability and stuff. So, but I'm curious to hear what you have to say about this.
Oh man, I have a lot of feelings about temperature and relative humidity, much more than we can cover here. Call me for more. There is a trend in conservation to widen the acceptable ranges of relative humidity and temperature in an attempt to both be more sustainable on your building and HVAC system and also embrace the understanding that objects, especially very old ones, have lived an entire life before they were put into climate control. And so there's an excellent article that I sent to Robin that maybe we should add to the annotated bib about object proofing, which is kind of talking about the most extreme environmental conditions an object has been exposed to. Unless it exceeds those, there's a likelihood that mechanical damage has kind of done what it's going to do. So there's that piece of it. And that is a consideration for things like the wooden handles. If there's a crack in the wood, the crack probably won't get worse. Parchment is its own beast with very high sensitivity to fluctuations in relative humidity. And so I would recommend thinking more about the fluctuations and how quickly they happen rather than the range, because very slow increase or decrease, the parchment is going to be able to equilibrate in a way that it feels comfortable and is not going to be like jerked in one direction or the other, is not going to become very brittle, very warped. And so one thing that helps the Torah itself buffer that is these really big rolls of parchment, which themselves kind of buffer changes in relative humidity. You then add this ceremonial dressing, which is also buffering changes in relative humidity. And then you have them placed in a separate storage nook that is closed, also buffering swings in relative humidity. And so it's really the swings I would be most concerned about for the parchment. Final answer.
Good answer. I'll also note that this came up, some of these questions came up in our January webinar as well, which is all about like sustainability and collections environments. Officially, we do still recommend we follow the ASHRAE standards, which I'm going to put the link in the chat so people have it. That's officially, but I think some of these, I would just keep noting this because as Marguerite said, they passed along an article to me, which I found very interesting. So this is like, again, Wild West territory a little bit right now, which I'm finding very fascinating. But
and I'll just quickly note that high temperatures are always bad. They accelerate any chemical reactions, including the degradation ones. So I will say that I feel more strongly about a strict maximum than I do about a minimum, because cold temperatures are usually better for the objects. Food for thought.
I think that sounds good. I think that's a perfect way to refer to it. Do you have recommendations for the exhibition of a Torah, particularly with respect to display orientation, visibility of text, rotation concerns?
Excellent question. Excellent question. Depends. Depends who is exhibiting it. It depends if the community has agreed that it's appropriate to put on display. Because again, it might have, you know, if it's not being used for ritual, does it have an expectation that it should be put to Geniza? Or does it have some educational value that supersedes that need? And can you really justify that? So that's one part of the question. The second part is there are the Torah is read once a year. Every week we read what is called a parsha. I don't know what that word is in English. Like portion, I think. And so that once a year you cycle through the whole Torah scroll. So in a way it kind of has a nice little rotation schedule already built in. If you're committed to doing it once a week, it could match up with, you know, the week that is being read then. There is also some conversation about modesty where, it's inappropriate for too many columns of text to be visible at once. So keeping it to two or three is appropriate, but more than that is questionable. Yeah, I think those are my initial thoughts. I'd be happy to chat with you more if you have specifics. But like any ink on parchment, keep it away from windows. If it has a vitrine, UV protective film, like steps to protect it from those agents of deterioration as you would a normal work on parchment.
Right. Yeah, I'll just note that, like, you know, it's, I think those general rules are perfect and really will help anyone when it comes to exhibiting these types of things, but it always is, there's always case by case scenarios too. So it's always just keep that in mind as well. When you're planning on these, we are planning to treat a megala. In which category would it go if it's very badly damaged?
Ooh, this is a good question, because a megala is like, okay, it's canonical, but it is not part of the Torah. It is part of the Tanakh, which is a more expanded version. And so the Megillah is the story of Esther and tells the historical narrative of Jews in Persia and their plights, struggles, and triumphs. And actually, I really think this is true, but the name of God does not appear once in that whole story. And so even though, and there's like a lot of talk of like, ooh, what does that mean? Is it a metaphor? But from a practical standpoint, it means that it's not top tier clay kodesh. It is, you know, ink on parchment that is maneuvered, right? Has that mechanical roll action, but does not contain the name of God and is therefore not top tier holy.
We got confirmation in the chat that the name of God does not appear in it.
So, there we go.
Thanks, chat.
Something stuck in there.
That is impressive. I'll go to this one first. Are there any restrictions about who is conserving treating objects, such as female versus male, unmarried versus married, ages above, below certain years, et cetera? I know I have had that experience working with tribal collections, mm-hmm. being told that there are certain items I shouldn't handle. Is there anything like that within Judaica collections?
It's very complicated and it depends on who you ask. I think the number of answers is the number of equal to the number of Jews in the world. I think everyone would have a different answer. There are some more traditional sects that are very binary, are very gendered, have very specific rules about genders. However, there are more progressive groups of Jewish people who embrace contemporary society and ways of thinking and are not so strict with gender. I mean, I'm a trans mask non-binary person, so should I really even be doing this? You know, there would be some people out there who would argue no. I invite them to shoot me an email and have a conversation. And it's complicated. If you have questions about it, I'd be happy to answer them on a kind of case-by-case basis. But I think my final answer is each Jewish community is going to have a particular response. And so it might be worth asking your local Jewish communities.
That's a smart way to go about it. Just because I've had the exact same experience with tribal communities, where some tribal communities have been very much like, yes, it does matter when it comes to me being a female who is of childbearing years, you know what I mean? Like, that is something important. Others have told me that it's not, because I am not native, you know what I mean? So mm-hmm. it doesn't apply to me. So I've had those kind of answers as well. And I think it really just depends on looking at your institution, talking to the communities, getting their opinion, and kind of going from there, making your best judgment. Because I think everyone has the knowledge that none of us want to make anyone upset, right? We're doing the best we can. So I think the more communication you have on it makes sense.
And I think this is where kavanah, intention, can come in. And you can say, okay, I know that I'm trans non-binary, and you know, the traditional Hasidic Jews are probably not chill with me existing, let alone like working on this historic object. And I can know that and still do my very best to do good by the object, knowing that. And so that mindfulness and bringing your whole self to the table as you're working, I think is part of that conversation.
That's a great way to put it. Thank you. Should Judaica items be separated from other objects in long-term storage, like other culturally sensitive objects from other cultures? Have you ever come across that in your experience?
That's so interesting. I don't know, but wouldn't it be cool to see them side by side on the same shelf? I mean, not ideal from like an organization, where can I find things on the shelf standpoint, but I can't think of an example of keeping it away from something else.
Yeah.
I can't think of an example.
I think, again, to me, it would just be like, if you saw something that maybe it was really sensitive, just go talk to someone, you know what I mean? Find an expert and really get their opinion on it. But I think that, yeah, it's hard. It's hard sometimes to pinpoint these things unless you have an actual example of one. I saw something. Oh, here we go. Someone in the chat, this is interesting. They learned that kosher ink contains iron gall in it. So be mindful of displaying it. So yes, we all know the joys of iron gall ink and what happens to that over time. So yeah.
And there's iron gall ink, and then there's proprietary ink. So it's like not good either way. So that is when knowing a sofer is helpful, and you can say, hey, what is it that you're actually using?
Oh, that's interesting in the chat. Going back to the ideas of being separated, people are talking about their experiences within Holocaust museums and that people would separate items of Judaica from Nazi items, which that makes sense, right? Like totally. I think that's a super good point. And I think that's one of those things that's case by case, right? Like that completely makes sense within it. And people are saying hi to each other in the chat now. So that's always
fun. That's always fun. In the annotated bibliography, there's a section Judaica and Judaica preservation. But as I was doing research, I found the term anti-Semitica, which is exactly what it sounds like, stuff that embodies anti-Semitism. And so there's a section for more reading in that annotated bibliography. So could be an interesting, you know, conversation piece.
I like that. Okay, so I'm gonna hit the last question in our chat or in the Q&A. It says, the bulk of our items, I believe, fall into the category of history, photographs, meeting minutes, those kind of items. I gather from the talk that it is okay to apply standard collections care practices, but are there any access concerns we should be thinking about? And they go on to say, our general approach is to make the collections available to everyone, but with the unfortunate rise in anti-Semitic incidents in the United States, should we be trying to police access to info about our local Jewish community members?
Well, isn't that an interesting question? Isn't that an interesting question? I will have to think about that and get back to you.
Yeah.
Because like there's, how would you verify? Like, check this box if you have, you know, anti-Semitic violent tendencies or intentions. I don't know, because you couldn't ask someone to prove that they're Jewish or prove that they deserve to see this. I think standard security measures, you know, if a patron, I'm not sure, you know, each institution has their own, but maybe you don't leave them alone in the, you know, reading room. There's always a staff member with them. Maybe those sorts of things. But I know that in Indigenous communities, there are restrictions to kind of what members of the community can interact with or experience certain objects. And to my knowledge, there's not a similar sort of barrier to different members of the Jewish community.
They just clarified a little bit in the chat saying, I was thinking like not putting it online, like our other photos, et cetera, which that's a choice. I mean, I think it would boil down to a couple things in my head, and I'm going to think a little bit more higher level as to what is your current access policy in your collections management policy, right? You're going to have to refer to that, refer to your governing body too. If for some reason you work at a state archives, like in my former state of Florida, there was a very thing called the Sunshine State Laws, which basically meant that if you were a public state archive, you had to provide access to all your things. It was a law, like you couldn't hide away certain access. That being said, if things are being abused or if there's a threat to staff or something like that, then I think that there is a case for putting some items on restricted access. So it's going to be kind of a higher up question, I think, than just someone kind of saying, no, you're not allowed to go in there because, you know, exactly what you said, you checked the wrong box or something. Like there's going to be some higher level questions for sure. So I would consider that.
I'm going to share this website in the chat. They're launching today with the goal of consolidating Jewish art and content online. It's in so many different places. And their goal is to kind of put it all in one place. And so they might be a place to reach out about how they handle putting Judaica or sensitive Judaic content online and what measures they have in place.
Perfect. Thank you. That was a great resource to throw on there on the last minute. So thank you for sharing that. Well, it is 2:00 Eastern. So I'm going to go ahead and close out today's program. I put, and also in the chat, our link to the resources, the annotated bibliography that you put in, and the link to the survey for this program. I encourage everyone to please fill out that survey. That helps us with future planning for the webinar series or any other things that we might be planning in the future. We're getting lots of little claps and love emotions coming up. So I think you did a great job,
Marguerite. Thank you. Thank you so much.
That was wonderful. Do you have any final words for our audience at all?
Chag Sameach to those celebrating Passover. Happy Easter to those celebrating Easter, and happy spring cleaning to everyone.
That's appreciated. Thank you. Well, thanks again to our presenter today, Marguerite Schinder. Thanks again to FAIC and IMLS for supporting this program. I will be posting the recording by the end of the week, I promise. And if anyone has any questions, feel free to put it to c2cc@culturalheritage.org. I hope everyone has a safe rest of the month, and we will see you on May 2nd for our May Day programming and emergency planning. So thanks again, and we will talk to you all soon.
Thank you so much.